I have interviewed at all these companies and received offers from Google, Meta, Amazon, and some others. As a naive beginner, I learned data structures like segment trees, B trees, and Bloom filters. After embarrassing myself in many coding interviews, I realized that none of this complex stuff is actually asked in the interviews. You see, most good online courses on data structures are taught by professors from some of the best universities, and these courses are designed to be as comprehensive as possible. These courses never claim to be tailored towards helping you crack interviews for programming jobs. But since there are not many courses created by industry experts on the subject, we are left with no choice but to use these advanced university-level courses that might not be best suited for coding interviews. To make your life a little easier, I will share the top 5 most asked data structures from my own interviewing experience. I'll also tell you when exactly to use these data structures. Let's do this. At number 5, we have heap. Heap is a tree-based data structure that is used to store a partially sorted set of elements. But what does that even mean? Let's examine this tree-like structure closely. If you pick any element or node on the tree, it's going to be greater than or equal to both of its children. This kind of heap is called a max heap. What this means is that the root or the topmost node of the tree is always going to be the maximum of all the elements. Similar to max heap, we also have a min heap, where every element is smaller than or equal to both of its children, and the root node is the minimum of all the elements. Now, the heap I showed you might look like a tree, but it's actually implemented using an array. So heap in this example can also be written like this array, which is partially sorted. For an element at index n, its children can be found at index 2n plus 1 and 2n plus 2. Any array can be converted into a heap using an algorithm called heapify. I will not go into the details of heapify, but I just want to make sure that you know all the important concepts for every data structure that we will discuss today. So when do you use a heap? The most important property of a heap is that it makes getting the maximum or the minimum of all the numbers very easy. So whenever you need a quick access to max or min, think about heap. For example, we can use heap to implement priority queues. A priority queue is a data structure where each element has a priority or a score associated with it. And when you remove an element from this data structure, you get the element with highest priority or score first. A heap is a perfect data structure to achieve this. Some famous algorithms where heap shows up are heap sort, Dijkstra's algorithm, and median maintenance for a stream. I highly recommend you read about these concepts on your own. At number 4, we have a binary tree. Each element of the node stores a value and links to its left and the right child. The topmost node of the tree is called root node, and the bottommost nodes are called leaf nodes. Binary trees are used in database indexing, sorting algorithms, and decision trees, etc. All that theory is fine, but when should you really be thinking about binary trees in a coding interview? Well, it's very simple. The interviewer will ask you to think about a binary tree herself. Binary tree questions would usually go something like this. Given a binary tree, do this. So you rarely have to think about whether you need a binary tree to solve a particular problem. But there are two important things that you need to know about binary trees. Number 1. Binary trees are perfect candidate to use recursion. For those who don't know, in a recursive algorithm, a function calls itself with a smaller input value and uses the result to return its output. Most binary tree problems can be solved using recursion. Number 2. You also need to know different ways to traverse a binary tree. Traversal is nothing but the process of visiting all the nodes of a tree. A few popular type of traversals that you should read about are pre-order, post-order, in-order, and level-order traversal. Some popular binary tree problems that you should know about are lowest common ancestor, left view of a tree, and maximum path sum. At number 3, we have a hashmap or hash table. Hashmap is a data structure that provides fast access to data based on a key. When you provide a key value pair to a hashmap, a hash function is used to map the key to a unique index in an array, and the value is stored at that index. For now, you can think of hash function as a black box that takes a key as input and gives out an index as the output. If the array already has a value stored at this index, a list can be used to store multiple values at this index. Enough about the theory. When should you think about using a hash map in an interview? While solving the problem, if you feel the need to get a particular information really quickly without using much work, you should think about using a hash map to store this information. For example, going through an array, you want to find the index of another number in the array that can be added to the current number to make the total sum equal to 100. All you want is the index of 100 minus the current number in the array quickly without doing a lot of work. If you have a hash map that contains all the numbers as key and their index as value, you can quickly look up the index of 100 minus current number. But here is one thing that you should be very careful about when using HashMap. Quick lookups in HashMap come at the cost of using extra space, and this might mean that your solution is suboptimal. So after you have found a solution using a HashMap, should always be thinking if there are better solutions that don't use extra space used by HashMap. It's not always possible to achieve that, but you should always try. At number 4, we have a stack. I'll also include queues here because they are very similar to stacks. Stack is a data structure that supports two main operations: adding an element, which is also called pushing, and removing an element, which is also called popping. In a stack, when you remove or pop an element, you always get the last element that you added to the stack. Last in, first out. Moving on to the queue. Adding an element to the queue is called enqueuing, and removing an element is called dequeuing. When you remove or dequeue an element from a queue, you always get the first element that you added to the queue. First in, first out. Under the hood, both stacks and queues are implemented using arrays or linked lists. I highly recommend you read about linked lists on your own. Moving on, a more important question that we have still not answered is when to think about a stack or queue in a coding interview. To be honest, stacks and queues are the hardest data structures to think about, as it's not obvious when to use them. Anyway, I'll try to share a few tips based on the patterns I've seen. Whenever you have some previously seen values and you know that you will need the last seen value first, use a stack. For example, in this hard problem where you need to calculate a math expression, you will be going into these nested brackets, and you need to keep track of what the sum was in the parent bracket before you entered the current bracket. Since you only care about the sum in the parent bracket, you should be thinking about using a stack here. Now, I know this explanation is not super clear, but I just want to give you some examples to think and read about. Another very interesting problem that uses a stack is called largest rectangle in a histogram. I highly recommend you read about these problems. Moving on to the top data structure on the list. At number 1, we have graphs. Many difficult problems asked in coding interviews use graphs. A graph is a data structure that contains a set of vertices and edges that connect these vertices. When the edges of a graph have a direction, it's called a directed graph. Otherwise, it's called an undirected graph. Wherever you spot relationships between different entities in a coding problem, you should be thinking about graphs. For example, if you're given bus routes that go through different bus stops, and you need to find a route from stop number 15 to stop number 12 with the minimum number of bus changes, you should be thinking about graphs because there is a clear relationship between entities bus, bus stop, and route. Now that you know when to think about graphs, I want to tell you a few important graph-related concepts that you should read about. First is graph search. Some famous graph search algorithms that you should read about are depth-first search, breadth-first search, and Dijkstra's algorithm. The last two algorithms I mentioned are used to find the shortest path between two nodes on the graph. I also recommend reading about topological sort and how to find a loop in a graph. As you might have already observed from this video, knowledge of data structures will not take you very far if you don't know different algorithms associated with them. If you want to know the top 5 algorithms from all the interviews I gave, watch this video. My name is Sahil, and I'll see you in the next one.